Oh, gee, but I have fun swallowing animals one by one.
We were not supposed to go to the movies. However, they always told, because I was a movie buff, you know, as a kid. I remember the Shirley Temple movies and all that. And they would smuggle us in once the lights were out, and we would leave before the lights go out, go on again, sit in some obscure row and see the movie. So there were people like that. Not too many, but there were some who were good.
Why would the Nazis prevent a young Jewish teenager from watching her favorite film stars? Holocaust education, when it exists, focuses on the destruction of Jews in Europe in World War II. But what about before all this? How did the Nazis manage to turn an entire country against an entire ethnic group? These are the questions that lie at the heart of Margot Capell's journey from eyewitness to war refugee. Here, Margot Capell recalls her childhood growing up in Edigheim, Germany. Edigheim was a small town located in the southwest region of Germany, near the border of France.
The only thing I can say about Edigheim, we were surrounded by Gentile neighbors, and I don't think I ever felt any different from anybody else. I had Gentiles, I had Jewish girlfriends, and we got along fine.
When Margot turned 8 and a half in the year 1928, her family, consisting of her mother, father, and brother, decided to move to the larger rural town of Welsheim to help take care of her grandfather.
We were totally integrated into the local community, and I know that was there a Jewish festival and anything, the Catholics, which was the only other religion in our town, could do to help, they would.
With religious Jews and Catholics coexisting in this primarily agricultural town, it wasn't obvious or apparent that there were any tensions. But this would slowly start to change.
My brother, who had been out, he's much older than I am, he was out that evening with friends, and he had come home and he surprised somebody who was trying to break in. And at that time, we didn't think that it has any, had anything to do with anti-Semitism. However, when he tried to go to the police and have it investigated, they just ignored him. They wouldn't do anything.
Soon, word spread of Nazi rallies and street fights. While Nazi candidates for election blamed the poor economic state of Germany on communists and Jews. And due to Germany's wounded national pride after their defeat in World War I and lack of political stability after the 1929 Depression, Germans began to listen to what 40-year-old Hitler and the Nazi Party were saying. Many Germans wanted a stronger nation, and if it meant more anti-Semitism, that was okay.
Of course, Hitler never held back. He always said what he was going to do, and of course, nobody took him at his word, but except my uncle. I remember my uncle coming home to Wilsheim, telling him he's going to get out of Germany because what's going eventually happen, all the Jews will have to go or else they're going to be killed. Well, as that was in 1930, everybody laughed at him and thought he was a little bit off. But he didn't, he said no, he said you will think of it, you will think of my words. And unfortunately, whatever he said came true.
By 1933, Hitler was appointed as chancellor, and the Nazi Party became the largest and then the only party in Germany. Back in Welsheim, there were boycotts against Jewish businesses, starting on April 1st, 1933. As Jewish teachers fled, Margot was transferred from a Hebrew school to a Catholic school, where she eventually became the only Jewish girl in her class.
You could tell that people wouldn't look you in the eye anymore when you met them on the street, and before you would even holler across the street, "Hi, how are you?" and they would turn their head and make believe they didn't see you.
The force of anti-Semitism grew with the passage of the 1935 Nuremberg Laws, enforced by local police under Heinrich Himmler. Some Jewish families started taking action to leave the town. Margot's brother left Germany that year to live with a relative in Sweden. In Catholic school, the nuns denied Margot the role of valedictorian because she was Jewish. After graduation, Margot worked at a millinery store in the nearby town of Freiburg.
Rumors started and people were seriously thinking of leaving. And the idea was at that time get the young people out and then have them establish roots somewhere, preferably in the United States, and then have them send for their parents. However, at that point, nobody really was anxious to have it. It was very difficult to go someplace else.
At age 18, Margot Capell took the initiative to apply for a visa to immigrate to the United States. Her parents applied shortly afterwards. Due to the strict U.S. quota system, they were forced to wait. But on November 9th, 1938, all that waiting would finally come to a standstill. That night, she and others in her Jewish youth group were told to leave the synagogue at once.
And on the way home, no sooner, I don't even think we reached home, when we heard a lot of noise and fire engine going, and then we were told that the synagogue had been set on fire. We had just left it maybe 10, 15 minutes before. By the time Kristallnacht came along, then we knew it was too late. They had let it go too far. Nobody had stopped it. Now there was no escape anymore.
By 1939, Margot had returned to Welsheim to find that her father, along with all the other men in the town, had been taken to the Dachau concentration camp. With the war imminent, Margot's family arranged for her to leave for England, where she would work in a household until her number was up to immigrate to the U.S.
I was considered an enemy alien because I was a German. I didn't care whether you were Jewish or whatever. I was a German and war was imminent, so therefore I'm an enemy. So I was very anxious to get out. So finally, my visa came through in England to go to the United States.
Margot sent the last letter she could to her parents in Germany and spent the night before her departure in an air raid shelter during the start of the London Blitz. But sure enough, in September 1940,
she would board the SS Beltrover
and sail for a treacherous 14 days before finally arriving in the US.
We finally pulled into Boston Harbor. I didn't come to New York, no Ellis Island, none of that for me. I arrived in Boston, and from there the Hayas took over, which I thought was wonderful. Somebody was on the boat to pick up refugees. They took us to a shelter. They notified my uncle. The next day they put me on a bus, bought me a New York Times, which scared me to death because I'd never seen anything like it, the size of it. And I traveled by bus to Manhattan, where my uncle met me at the bus station.
Margot was invited to move to her aunt and uncle's farm in Hartford, Connecticut, where she had a job waiting for her. And for once, in what seemed like forever, she began to feel like she belonged.
So I managed to get a job wrapping gift package. They trained me to wrap gift package. And I know the people on my floor, there was lingerie, they were so wonderful to me. I mean, I had never experienced that before. On Christmas Eve, everybody came with a little gift. I was so touched. I couldn't believe it.
At that time, Margot was unable to communicate with her mother and father, and was only aware that they had stayed in a camp in France before being transferred to Poland.
And that was the end of it. After that, I didn't hear anymore. The unoccupied part of France became occupied, and through all this delay, my parents perished.
Margot Capell would never stop attempting to find out what happened to her parents, although she was never successful. Her loneliness eased when she met her husband, Eric Capell, at a local dance in Hartford. They were married in 1943 and were together for 50 years. Margot worked in different businesses sewing hats and as an owner of a candy shop until moving to Brooklyn and then to Staten Island, where Margot currently lives. Margot eventually met up with her brother, who'd been living in Sweden, when she visited Germany again in 1978. To this day, Margot is active within her community, telling her story to the next generation and spreading her message of standing up to injustices of any kind.
All I can say, keep your eyes open, and if you see anything happen, I don't care how small an incident, do something about it. Don't wait until it grows into a big incident. And don't say like we do, it will pass, because it doesn't. It still exists. Anti-Semitism exists. It's there. It rears its ugly head. Step on it. Whenever you see something, do something about it. Don't turn away from it. Don't be afraid. This is a free country. The world should have learned something. It didn't. But it's up to us to be vigilant and see to it that it will never happen again. And if we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it for us. That is for sure.